Welcome, everybody, to the Fall Line with Chaos and Company. We're here tonight, and of course, I'm here with Angelo Ross, and we're going to be doing a little quick hitter for What's Bugging Angelo. And Angelo, what's bugging you tonight?
First of all, the title of these, because I'm not, it's not, but, all right, it's bugging me a little bit. But it's bugging me.
Both of us.
Right. Yeah. But listen, this is not intended to be preachy. You know what I mean? Like when we do these little quick clips and talk about things, it's meant to be reflective. And I think these are things that we all as teachers, and not even just limited to being a ski teacher, any kind of teacher needs to reflect, you know, if you have the intention of improving. So that I want to say that first, because I'm not really bugged. You know, I'm just thinking about stuff. But
Because these are the things that you and I talk about that they're really, I mean, if we put it there, it's bugging both of us, but it's that conversation we have of what are we not getting to our staffs? What are we not getting to the pros that they're interpreting a different way? Or what are we not getting information to help them out? It's kind of the way I look at it. So, you know, it's kind of that joking thing, what's bugging us, but it's more, and it's not to be preachy, like you said, it's more to like, you know, how can we, and this, the podcast itself, is trying to connect with them to say, hey, here's some thoughts. Maybe put this in your teaching and see if this helps out a little bit.
Your pipe and smoke it. Yeah. That's what my dad says.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But I've been thinking about since we had Eric Lipton on, and he made a really great point about how, you know, to actually assess how much time people in your lessons spend moving versus standing. So I've been thinking about that quite a bit. And then, you know, taking that a step farther, I've been thinking a lot about what are we teaching people? You know, in other words, when someone has spent, say, an hour with one of us, what did they practice? What did they have the opportunity to get better at? And, you know, we did one of these about over-terraining, because I've been watching a lot of instructors put students in the situation where what they're practicing for that hour or for that 2 hours or for that entire day is they are practicing doing a big wedge straight down the fall line. You know?
Yeah,
that bugs me a little bit, because there's so much more available, you know? Yeah. So I started thinking about this idea of what are we teaching people? And then the corollary is what aren't we teaching them? So what opportunities are we missing? And this is for all of us. This is not pointed at anybody, but it's like, if I spend an hour in a clinic with some instructors and I say these things, what didn't I say? You know, what didn't I touch on? So I had a conversation with an instructor the other day about a lesson where the student spent an hour in a pretty big wedge pointing down the fall line. And I said, what did that person learn? We had a little discussion on that, and we arrived at, you know, what that person practiced or what that person learned was how to do a big wedge better, you know, and in and of itself, there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, I skied all day today. Hey, I skied the East today. I'm wearing my ski the East toboggan.
You didn't snowboard today.
I skied in the East, but, there's nothing wrong with a big wedge. I used it today when I was skiing the East, you know, you gotta have it, but where that conversation with this instructor went was, what didn't you practice? What didn't that person do? And it was like, what do you mean by that? And I said, well, I didn't see a whole lot of straight running, which we need to do. I didn't see a lot of traversing, which is good to do. I didn't see any herringbone. I didn't see any sidestep. I didn't see any skating. I didn't see any bouncing. I didn't see any shuffling. And then the point was made, and I wasn't trying to be like a prick. You know, I'm like saying, just trying to plant the seed that there are all these different things that we do during a ski day. But if we only spend time practicing this big wedge straight down the fall line, we're never touching those things. And we're not making our students very independent or we're not giving them a lot of variety in their own tactics.
Yeah. They get kind of stuck in that, they have that step they're trying to do. And then you just keep repeating the step, repeating the step, repeating the step. And that's where it's that, what do I step back to? And for me, it's if it just the things you're saying, like the straight run, I do a thing at level one, the level one exam as an educational piece for those guys, just a straight run. They can do anything they want in a straight run other than turning, skating, and stopping and a wedge. So no wedge, no stopping. You know, we let the terrain stop. I try to pick a spot that they don't have to worry about stopping, and they can do anything they want other than that. And they get after, and they have to keep cycling. So I just have them going, they're coming down, and they have to keep hiking up, and they have to go like eight times. So you just keep cycling, one down, another one's coming down. And each person has to do something different. When you got seven or eight people in a group, that's 48 different combinations. So they think just lifting a foot's the same thing. It's like, well, lifting the right foot's different than lifting the left foot. You've got to balance on a different foot. You got to move for coordination. And lifting the foot up, and then, you know, with your hands up in the air, or lifting your foot up while you're reaching down to touch something. So trying to set people off balance, but you can do a bunch of different stuff. You can just lift the tail of the ski, just lift the tip of the ski, anything to try to get people to move their body, move their skis in a different way. Pick the ski up and then rotate it over the tip of the other one while the other one's going straight. Can they keep the other ski going straight? All those things to try to get independence of body parts, get independence of joints. And when you're lifting one foot up, it's not about lifting the ski and for balance per se. For me, it does help that, but it's more about they had to flex and close the hip joint and the knee joint to lift that foot off the snow. You know, like you had mentioned, the shuffle, have them shuffle in the straight run. They've got to open and close the ankle joint to move the feet back and forth. They're also using the hip joint and all those things. They can hop in a straight run. They can, you know, just hop the tails off the snow. They can reach down. And we, with the kids, we'll throw a snowball out to one side and they got to reach for it. We'll have a snowball in the snow they got to pick up. I did this with a group when I had my New Heart Clinic, and I put snowballs, and I had big snowballs and little snowballs. And for the big snowballs, they had to do a certain thing. For the little snowball, they had to do something else. So then I'd move the snowballs so that then they had to make their ski go around one snowball. And then the little snowball, they lifted it up over it. So it was different stuff like that to just, and it wasn't about, I mean, a lot of people just think balance, but for me, it's like, it was the creativity and the fun of getting somebody to make the joints move, mm-hmm. or to somebody they had to move the center, which isn't that balance, but it's also a little bit of how we're balancing over which foot. You know, or developing pressure on one foot versus the other, that foot to foot movement. Cause you're lifting one foot up, you get a balance in the other foot. So it's starting that foot to foot movement that we need to have. So I'm thinking more just in get people to move. And I think that's what you're seeing when people are just in the wedge and they just trying to do the wedge over and over again, trying to hold it, or they're trying to get the first turn. They're not really trying to get them to move. They just keep going, turn your feet, point your feet over there, mm-hmm. point your belly button over there. Mm-hmm. Now make your skis go that way. Point the right foot. Headlights on the knees, but it's the same thing. It's not a movement thing. It's just another coaching cue. Mm-hmm.
I think a very good thing for any teacher to do is reflect. And with regard to ski teaching or snowboard teaching, you know, how many activities on flats can you list just off the top of your head by yourself? Get a piece of paper, get a pencil, and just list how many different things you can do on flat terrain. And, you know, you can pull, you can shuffle, you can step, you can skate backwards, you can herringbone backwards, you know, and then sit down with a buddy and say, you know, how big was your list? Let's see what we can add to these lists and come up with all these things. But then are you doing them in your lessons? You know, something like a backwards herringbone may not seem relevant, but how many times in a lift corral do you get your tip on the wrong side of the corral? You know what I mean? Yeah. And you have to back up a little bit. It happens all the time. So it's a useful move.
Yeah. I love it. I love doing the backwards herringbone just because it makes them move their foot backwards. I mean, we think of the fundamentals, and, you know, they try to think of the fundamentals so much in the concept of it. But when you think of the basis, you know, the center of mass, the relationship of the center of mass over the base support, they're moving a foot back and they're moving their feet back. So they're moving the feet under the basis of the base support under the center of mass, mm-hmm. where so much they're always thinking about moving the center of mass. So I love that one. I mean, I love getting them in a wedge and then making them herringbone backwards uphill. So their back is up the hill and they're in the wedge and they're using the wedge instead of facing uphill and herringboning. Mm-hmm. That one I love doing. And you got to do it on something like you're saying, it's got to be gentle. You could do that on the flats. you don't have to do it on the hill. You could do the herringbone backwards. You can do the wedge and then try to do a move backwards while you're in the wedge, doing the step like you're doing a herringbone mm-hmm. on the flats before you go to any kind of pitch. And that's what I think you're saying, which is really good. I think everyone thinks they need gravity. They need to have a hill to be able to do most of these activities. And if they want some momentum, mm-hmm. a lot of our guests, our students have poles. Use propulsion. I mean, it's kind of neat to see all the people that are out cross country skiing. You use your poles with cross country for propulsion. Have them push a little bit for a little momentum if you want something to be from momentum mm-hmm. on the flat, so they don't have to worry so much about going down the hill and crashing.
Well, and I think a very good thing to add to that list, if it isn't already on there, are activities where you go from, and this is good for skiing and snowboarding, from edges on one side to flat to edges on the other side. Yeah. Or on the snowboard, you know, edge, flat, edge. So on a snowboard, you can do that in a straight run. And you don't even have to have both feet buckled in. Just the front foot. And you can pressure the toes and do a little carve this way, little direction change, and then pressure the heels and do the little direction change this way. On a very flat hill, you know, with virtually no speed. And same thing on skis. You can pole and do, you know, big toe, pinky toe on one side, and then big toe, pinky toe on the other side as you're poling, and do these mini super slow railroad track turns. But I think if you're doing things like that, where you're getting guests, getting your students to go flat and then edge the other way, you're really putting some good building blocks in there for the next lesson. You sell the next lesson, and, you know, presumably you're going to be going a little faster, maybe a little steeper. Going edge, flat, edge, regardless of gear, is uber valuable. But if all that's being practiced in a lesson is a power wedge, you're never going from edge to flat to edge.
Right.
Right. And same thing on a snowboard. If all you're practicing is a toe side slip or a heel side slip, you never make that crossover move. And I think that's really vital at the low levels, because, you know, hopefully they're going to come back. We get that conversion rate up above 17.5% to 87.5%. You are going to have things down the road, and you plant those crossover moves early in their sliding career, and you're going to build better athletes on the gear down the road.
Yeah. Cause I guess we all pretty much suck when we look at that conversion rate, huh? We can't even say we're pretty good if we're at that, like, I don't even want to mention the number, but you know, it's neat. You were just talking about just the board or just the ski. Can we make the ski go flat? Can we make the ski skid? You know, can you do it in a rail track and push with your poles? Whether you're on the, you know, if you don't have poles running the board, can you just do it, what you're saying, like on 1 foot? And those are just coaching. Those are things to, like, hey, can you do this with your board? Can you do this with your skis? And I don't think there's enough of that when they're just in the power wedge. They're just trying to achieve that one goal of hold the wedge, control speed, red light, green light. And what you're talking about, even if you weren't even talking about body part movements, you're just talking about, hey, can you make your tool do this? And it becomes a game or a little bit of a trick, you know, and that's where the fun comes in. And that's where we've got to get that conversion rate up to, hey, see if you can make your ski do this. Mm-hmm. Can you get it to do a railroad track on the flats, you know, and have them push through some turns, skate a little bit, and then try to make one turn on the railroad track. You know, can you make a line in the snow with your ski? Mm-hmm. Even if they're in somewhat of, you know, you got little kids, you know, if they get a little bit skating and see if they can put the ski on edge and just make that almost in a wedge, make that little ski, just one ski railroad track. So it's,
well, and that's something you can do both directions too, because how many times does a student come to a stop and slide backwards? So if you introduce them to that in a really controlled environment, you know, maybe it's not as terrifying when it happens out, you know, when they're on their own.
Yeah. And I think there's two pieces, hopefully, people take away from this little hitter. Is one is, for me, is just stop teaching and start moving. And that's kind of what you're talking about, you know, and Eric talked about that. If we can let people move more, because what we enjoy about the sport is doing it and moving and taking some runs and going skiing and going riding. And we need to let them do that more. So let them move in all the activities and different ways that we've been talking. This short period is about moving. Let them move. Let the movement teach them. I think we're too wrapped up into the perfect movement. I mean, if I want someone to flex their inside leg, I just have them pick the leg up to start. I'll just start making turns and just picking legs up. You know, we do the kids, and whether you want to call it thump or any of those games, it's more about, can they move the body parts and have the joints bend and unbend, you know, flex and so that's one thing. And then the other thing is have more fun, you know, make it fun in terms of see who can do it the fastest, who can do it the slowest, those kinds of things. Put some of the things in there that we don't talk enough about, are the duration, the intensity, rate, and timing of movements. They don't have to be perfect, but who can make, you know, we have kids jump up and down, and who can make their skis land the loudest? Who can make their skis land the quietest? Mm-hmm. It's the same thing. It's, you know, who can lift their foot up and keep it up the longest? Who can step around the corner the fastest? You know, and do all that stuff can be done on the flats, little skating relay races or something, anything to make it more fun and kind of a game versus work. It's not supposed to be work. Nope. At least not for our students. So, yeah. So, all right. Well, just a little one for you guys out there and gals, and hopefully you're enjoying the podcast. This is the Fall Line with KS and Company.
Enjoy.